Welcome to a special Christmas edition of Inside Politics. I'm Manu Raju. John King is off. Asian markets are down as the president is asked whether his Treasury Secretary still has his confidence. Plus, outgoing Democratic Senator Claire McCaskill tells me she's a little confused why incoming Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is, quote, the thing. And on day four of the government shutdown, President Trump finds a common thread between his fight for the border wall and the Russia probe.
As soon as I said I want to build the wall, they were all against it. It's like, take another example. Take Comey. Everybody hated Comey. They thought he did a horrible job. The Democrats hated him. Literally, the day before I fired him, they were saying he should be fired. As soon as I fired him, they said, oh, what did you fire him for? That was a terrible thing to do. It's a disgrace what's happening in our country. But other than that, I wish everybody a very Merry Christmas.
Very Merry Christmas indeed. We start with the president entrenched in his White House foxhole. His Christmas wishes coupled with Christmas complaints. The president's border wall is still the sticking point in a shutdown standoff now on its fourth day. This morning, the president had no answers for federal employees worried about their next paycheck.
I can't tell you when the government's going to be open. I can tell you it's not going to be open until we have a wall, a fence, whatever they'd like to call it. I'll call it whatever they want. But it's all the same thing. It's a barrier from people pouring into our company, into our country.
The president says he won't budge on the border wall, but in his remarks, there are signals his demands are again moving. In another phone call with troops, with another extended rant, the president put his inner monologue on public display. The optics of the Oval Office session hint at the president's mindset. He's increasingly alone and increasingly under siege. His life, political, professional, and personal, all under investigation. He's about to lose control of the House. And asked this morning about what happens when Democrats assume power, the president repeated a familiar line.
Well, then it's probably presidential harassment, and we know how to handle that. I think I handle that better than anybody. And there's been no collusion. After 2 years, no collusion. There has been collusion, but it's been by the Democrats.
CNN's Abby Phillip is live at the White House. And Abby, the president says he wants a wall, but is creating some wiggle room on what exactly the wall is and how much he needs. What can you tell us about that?
Well, Mani, what we saw this morning from the president was shifting demands and shifting claims about the status of the situation on the border. First, he said, you can call it whatever you want, a fence, perhaps steel slats. Then he said he wants 500 miles of wall, maybe 550. That's down from 900 miles of wall that about a year ago he said was necessary at the border. This is a president who is digging in his heels on the demand for funding for something that he can call to his supporters a border wall, but also is saying at the same time that wall is already being built at the southern border and that he simply wants to finish it before the next election. Now, therein lies the underlying problem with this whole issue is that President Trump wants this for his base, and Democrats are unwilling to give him that political victory. President Trump going even so far as to say that federal workers he's talked to have already said that they want him to keep the government closed until he gets his border wall funding. Now, President Trump is here in Washington for the fourth day after canceling plans to go to Florida, and his aides are already signaling that this will not end soon. Mick Mulvaney over the weekend made the point that federal workers' next paycheck that might be affected by this shutdown is not for another week or two. So I think we're getting into territory here where President Trump doesn't seem to be giving in much, but he clearly is signaling that he wants this political victory so he can go into his election campaign with a win. Manu.
Yeah, shut down that could last for some time. Abby Phil from the White House, thanks so much. And here with me in the studio to share their reporting and their insights, Alana Shore with the Associated Press, Jake Sherman with Politico, David Drucker with the Washington Examiner, and CNN's Sarah Murray. I want to start with what Abby was referring to about the president's remarks from this morning. One of the things that stuck out to me was he made it very clear this wall needs to be done before 2020. This is tied in his mind very clearly to the next election. I mean, I wonder how much you think that his base will punish him if he's not able to get funding for this wall, if it doesn't if he's not able to carry through with this promise?
Well, he clearly believes there will be consequences from his base. I mean, witness, you know, the backlash among conservative pundits that drove him to this remarkable about face that brought us to where we are today. And also his withdrawal from Syria, which he announced, is another promise to his base. So clearly Trump is already in preparing for re-election mode.
Yeah, he is. And he also doesn't seem to be feeling much pressure from the roughly 800,000 workers or so who have been impacted by this, many of whom are furloughed, some of whom are working without paychecks. He was asked about these workers today, his concerns about them, or if he had any concerns about them. This was his message to them.
Well, I think they understand what's happening. They want border security. The people of this country want border security. You know, it's not a question of me. I'd rather not be doing shutdowns. Many of those workers have said to me and communicated, stay out until you get the funding for the wall. These federal workers want the wall.
So in case you missed that, he said many of these workers have said to me and communicated, stay out until you get funding for the wall. I mean, this is a president that does not seem to be feeling any heat whatsoever to try to get a deal anytime soon.
Well, Treasury is shut down, so I'm not sure many Treasury employees are communicating their desire for a wall to him. But with each passing day, I think it's safe to say the president loses more leverage as Democrats get closer to holding a majority and Democrats get emboldened to block Trump. I mean, this is the president is entering what will be, and we don't know if he understands this because he's not acting like it, but the most hostile period of his presidency so far. And this shutdown is going to stretch at least until the new year from what we see now, and possibly, you know, midway into January, as Democrats have literally zero incentive to give in after the president has kind of rejected a host of offers that they've put forward to them.
And yeah. I think what you guys have seen, I mean, shutdowns, they get worse the longer they go. So it's one thing to be in this sort of partial shutdown when, you know, some people, it hasn't hit their paychecks yet. It could still be a couple weeks where people are on holiday, they're enjoying their sort of Christmas vacation, and so they're kind of tuned out to all of this as it is. But the longer it goes on, the worse it gets. The more you start seeing the stories of these consequences, the more you hear the stories of people who are expecting paychecks and aren't getting them, people who still have to show up and go to work without pay. And I think that's when the president begins to feel the pressure. It's not surprising to me, you know, if he's holed up at the White House all alone, that he doesn't necessarily feel this political pressure yet.
And he made a point of saying his family's down in Florida. Mm-hmm. He's not able to spend it with them. You mentioned shutdowns past, one of which is from 2013, that lasted for more than 2 weeks. What was different between that shutdown, which we all covered, and this one, is that there were a lot of negotiations that were happening. The president, President Obama brought Republicans and Democrats to the White House multiple occasions. Those may not have been fruitful, but there were at least some talks. This is what happened several years ago.
The congressional Republican leadership came to the White House and met with the president for more than 3 hours, but again failed to break the impasse.
The president basically called us all down there to tell us he's not interested in negotiating. It was essentially a negotiation about not negotiating. And now we hear he's off campaigning today in Rockville rather than sitting down to get this thing solved, which is certainly disappointing.
So that first one was Newt Gingrich walking into the White House when Bill Clinton, during the Bill Clinton shutdowns, and this was after McConnell met with President Obama and criticized him, saying he was certainly disappointing the president was interested in not negotiating, but at least they were talking. There's no talking that's happening.
Yeah, look, I think for a lot of these Republicans and Democrats, they've gotten so used to these shutdowns, they just don't have the same sense of urgency they used to. But what's remarkable about this shutdown, and you play the Mitch McConnell clip there, is McConnell has always tried to place himself at the center of any negotiation or non-negotiation. And in this case, he ceded everything to Schumer and said, you go make a deal with the president. Why did he do that? Because the president actually made a deal with Republicans and Democrats in the Senate. Mitch McConnell had all of his members walk the plank and vote for a CR that actually could hurt them in a future primary. And then the president goes and changes his mind. Republicans in the Senate don't have any interest in cutting any more deals with the president that he might change his mind on. And that's one of the reasons why this impasse is going, I think, to last past the third. Democrats will take the House. And then you look at the problem the president has, because shutdowns are political questions. Who knows where voters a couple of weeks from now decide they are on this. They might say, you know, the president's not being so unreasonable. Give him some more money for the wall. Let's end this thing. But the reason the president's having trouble getting money for the wall specifically from Democrats is one, the 40-seat drubbing that House Republicans took when the president spent the final weeks of that campaign talking about the wall and the caravan and all of that, and it all failed, and it's become toxic.
And
just like Manu, Obamacare during the Obama years, when people would poll on health care, oh, they like everything that's in it. Well, what about Obamacare? No, we don't like that. So, yeah, people like border security. The middle class likes border security. Moderate voters like border security. Right now, they're not so hot on Trump's wall, and that's why Democrats are emboldened.
And, you know, you mentioned the Republicans not knowing where Trump is. That was certainly the indication last week in talking to members on the Hill after they didn't know where Trump was, even after meeting with them. Democrats, too, are saying the same thing. Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi putting out their statement yesterday. They made a lot of statements, but this stuck out to me. He said different people from the White House, from the same White House, are saying different things about what the president would accept or not accept to end his Trump shutdown, make it impossible to know where they stand at any given moment. And then they criticize the president for being guided by the House Freedom Caucus, saying it's hard to come up with a solution, to see a solution that can come out and can pass both chambers. I mean, that's been the big issue here, right? I mean, we don't know where the president stands right now. At least members don't.
And not only that, I mean, all of what David said about Republicans in the Senate is true. Look at Senate Democrats. A lot of their members in vulnerable races, Senator McCaskill, who you'll talk to later in the show for one, are lost. They're gone from Washington. So Chuck Schumer used to have this position of, man, I got to protect some of these guys in red states. And maybe we got to perhaps think about cutting a deal on this. Now he has very little incentive to do that.
And one of the interesting things from this morning, too, the president tried to tie this to James Comey. He unprompted to criticize the Democrats, saying they'd taken hypocritical positions, just like they did with James Comey.
Take Comey. Everybody hated Comey. They thought he did a horrible job. The Democrats hated him. They were calling for his resignation. They were calling for his firing, including Schumer, including Nancy Pelosi, until I fired him. As soon as I fired him, they said, oh, what did you fire him for? That was a terrible thing to do.
I mean, the merits of the argument aside, I mean, he's trying to make the case that the Democrats have taken both sides. But he also said that he owned this issue. He was going to own the shutdown. He clearly is trying to show that the Democrats should be the blame.
The argument that Democrats were for massive border security is completely disingenuous, because they were for $46 billion in border security when it came along with massive changes to the immigration system in this country. So yes, they were
including a pathway to citizenship.
They were for border security, and Democrats as a broad proposition remain for border security, but are not for a $5 billion wall in and of itself.
Yeah, and I think part of what gets lost in this is just that it's also just not great policy. I mean, even Republicans don't think it's great policy to be like, yeah, let's drop another $5 billion into like throwing some concrete blocks. Like, no one who is on the border thinks the answer is to build this big, enormous wall. There are lots of things you could do to beef up the border. They don't necessarily involve a concrete wall or whatever Trump wants to make it out of. And there are lots of things you can do to sort of improve border security in general, and those mainly have to do with the visa process, not building this big, glorious wall on the border.
And that opens up a whole new...
So part of what's stuck in this is just not good policy.
And that opens up a whole new can of worms that we certainly... It's not going to get resolved in this fight. No, not anytime soon, but more to come ahead. By spending Christmas in the Capitol, President Trump ends a holiday streak that lasted 18 years. Not since 2000 as a president spent Christmas in Washington. And that was Bill Clinton's last year in office. The Clintons had dinner at the White House, did some shopping, attended midnight mass. We'll be right back. Welcome back. The economy also on the president's mind during that Oval Office meeting today, as he vented more frustration over the Fed's decision to raise interest rates once again. Now, the U.S. markets are closed for Christmas, but some exchanges in Asia picked up where Wall Street left off on Christmas Eve. CNN's business correspondent Allison Kosick is with us now. Allison, global traders clearly struggling to find anything positive as December winds down.
That has certainly happened overnight. So what often happens is you see global markets move in lockstep with U.S. markets, especially when you see such dramatic moves as we saw yesterday in the U.S., where we saw the Dow fall 650 points. So overnight, we saw Japan's Nikkei average fall 5% into bear market territory. That's a 20% fall from a recent high. China's Shanghai Composite falling 2.5% during the session, but making up some of those losses. So clearly, the U.S. problems become other countries' problems as well, or concerns concerns in this point. And one analyst putting it this way, the market seems to be getting pummeled in every direction. So globally, there are worries about an economic slowdown, not just here in the U.S., but around the world as well. There are there's the issue of the unresolved trade situation between the U.S. and China. And then, of course, there are the concerns, at least in the market, of the Fed, the Federal Reserve, really not pulling back on its path of raising rates, something to the consternation of President Trump. And that brings me to my other prong of concern for the market. Now, something new, it's political risk, something that usually didn't affect the market as much as it is now. Up until now, I think how the market saw President Trump when he would tweet about the Fed, about the markets, it would be more of a distraction. Now we're actually seeing President Trump, when he tweets, impact the market's moves. I saw this yesterday, 10:45, when the president tweeted saying that the economy, there's nothing wrong with the economy, that the Fed is the problem. We saw the market take a turn for the worse. We saw the market plunge to that 650 points lower on the Dow. It had been on an upswing, Manu, before Trump tweeted that. Manu?
Allison Kosick in New York for us. Thanks so much. Sure. You know, the big back of all the market volatility has been friction between the president and the Federal Reserve over rising interest rates and a bizarre failed effort from Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin to soothe the markets, or at least attempt to. Trump was asked just this morning if he had confidence in his Treasury Secretary.
Very talented, yeah, very smart person.
What about the Fed chair?
Well, we'll see. They're raising interest rates too fast. That's my opinion, but I certainly have confidence.
I mean, it's hard to overstate how much the president must be concerned about the state of affairs. Obviously, he's used this as a central point of his presidency. Look at what he tweeted last year at this exact same time about the economy. He said, we're delivering historic tax relief for the American people. He said the stock market is setting record after record and unemployment is 17-year low. He said that all signs are that business is looking really good next year, only to help by their tax cut legislation that they had just passed. He said that this is going to be a great year for companies and jobs, obviously not ending on the note he wanted.
Look, one of the reasons U.S. markets and the U.S. economy is so resilient compared to our competitors, and this is even in down periods, is because there's a certain level of political stability that comes with putting your money into the United States. And the president is turning all of that on its head, in a sense, to defend his own performance in the economy. In a sense, I'm so concerned that I'm going to get blamed for this, I'm just going to blame the Fed. And look, you can argue about monetary policy, you can argue about tax policy. Markets don't like unpredictability and upheaval. And having a president call out the Fed chair is the last thing you want to do when you're going to have some possible natural softening as the sugar high from the tax reform bill wears off, as the president's multi-front trade, let's say trade war or trade dispute or, you know, attempt to rejigger U.S. trade policy continues. All of these things make markets nervous. But you're going to make it worse if you're the president of the United States and you're yapping about the Fed on Twitter. The best thing he could do is just leave it alone, but he does not know how to do that.
He doesn't know how to do that. We've seen that time and again. But it was interesting today. I mean, he didn't take a whack at Jay Powell. I thought he was going to come after him when he was asked about it. He sort of took his foot off the gas. He said, we'll see. How long is that going to last? Maybe, did he learn from yesterday?
Maybe someone showed him the market dive that happened after he decided to take to Twitter yesterday. I mean, look, yes, there's a reason people put money into the U.S. because of political stability, but also because the Fed is independent, and the stock market prizes that independence. The Fed does not make monetary policy based on what the stock market is doing day in and day out. You know, they look at the long-term trends, obviously, but that's the way investors like it. That's the way the U.S. monetary policy system is supposed to work. And when the president decides he's going to inject himself in it and he's going to decide he knows better than everyone who works for him because he has a private business that he has run for his life, so he understands how monetary policy works and should decide on it today
because of his gut.
Yes, you're going to rattle the markets. So, yes, you know, maybe someone got that.
And listen to him this morning also blaming President Obama, or at least saying President Obama had low interest rates.
The economy is doing so well that they raised interest rates, and that's as a form of safety, in a way. President Obama didn't do much of that. Much easier to run when you have no interest rate. He had a very low interest rate. We have a normalized interest rate. A normalized interest rate means a lot. You know, it's good for a lot of people. They have money in the bank. They get interest on their money. For many years, nobody got interest on their money.
I mean, it's a standard Trump blaming Obama, but he also has criticized Obama's economy, but now it says that Obama benefited from a low interest rate. Does that argument square?
I mean, the statute of limitations on comparing yourself to Obama has already run out. You know, we're talking about years ago at this point. And I think this has to be seen of a piece, right? His comments about the Fed and the shutdown. It paints a picture of a government that investors cannot rely on. They have no idea what Trump is going to do next, and it's clearly showing.
Also, Obama had double-digit unemployment. So, yeah, he had low interest rate. Like, what is the
Very sluggish job market. Remember what Republicans said about it. They felt it was overregulated. They didn't feel it grew fast enough. And apparently they felt a lot better about this economy until, you know, a few days ago.
But look at the broad picture here. You have the president's advisors almost every day saying we have a hot economy. Meanwhile, the stock market is nosediving. And across the globe, we don't see any positive signs for any economy. Every single asset class on planet Earth is down this year.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure what the president's advisors are seeing. And then investors say we can't take this seriously anymore. And that's why the economy is slow.
And a lot of fears, clearly, at the White House, including this morning. Next, an exit interview with Democratic Senator Claire McCaskill. But first, big Christmas get-togethers equal big preparations for Senator Chuck Grassley. And that means 24 people and a vacuum cleaner. We think he named Beth. I'm 24 hours late getting Beth cranked up to have house clean for Christmas celebration, Grassley tweeted. Mrs. G and daughter Wendy have mostly finished food for approximately 24 people. Good luck with that, Senator. We'll be right back. After over a decade of service in the United States Senate, Democrat Claire McCaskill is bowing out. She lost a re-election campaign last month to a Trump favorite, Missouri Attorney General Josh Hawley. McCaskill tried in her campaign to bridge the divide between herself and Trump supporters, in part by distancing herself from members of her own party.
Claire's not afraid to stand up against her own party.
Yep, and Claire's not one of those crazy Democrats.
I sat down with Senator McCaskill before she left Washington.
You said you're not one of those crazy Democrats. What propelled you to say that, and who are those crazy Democrats?
Well, we have a state senator in Missouri that put on her Facebook that she thought President Trump should be assassinated. That's a crazy Democrat. Mm-hmm. The people during Trump's inauguration that were breaking windows, that's a crazy Democrat. People who go into restaurants and scream in elected officials' faces when they're eating with their families, those are crazy Democrats. That doesn't mean I don't believe in my party.
What about people like then for new New York Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez? Is she a crazy Democrat?
I don't know her. I'm a little confused why she's the thing, but it's a good example of what I'm talking about, a bright and shiny new object. Came out of nowhere and surprised people when she beat a very experienced congressman. And so she's now talked about a lot. I'm not sure what she's done yet to generate that kind of enthusiasm, but I wish her well. I hope she hangs the moon, but I hope she also realizes that the parts of the country that are rejecting the Democratic Party, like a whole lot of white working class voters, need to hear about how their work is going to be respected and the dignity of their jobs and how we can really stick to issues that we can actually accomplish something on. The rhetoric's cheap. Getting results is a lot harder. I mean, everybody knows they're not going to get 60 votes for free college for everybody in the United States Senate anytime the next three cycles. That's not going to happen. So that's great to talk about it in the campaign, but all that does is make people more cynical that believe in you when you don't get it done. And the way you get things done here is by reasonable negotiation and compromise and finding things that people agree on, like the cost of prescription drugs, like opioids, like criminal justice reform. We can do it. And somebody who talks about leading in that direction is the one that can win places like Florida, Ohio, Wisconsin, Michigan, and maybe even compete in a place like Missouri.
Do you think Elizabeth Warren could win those places?
I don't know. I think it's hard.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know.
Have you been surprised that Republicans have not said more to this president about these legal problems that he's had over the past couple of years and about his attacks against the FBI, that they've not, for the most part, stood up to him? Has that surprised you?
Yeah, it has with some of them. I'm really perplexed that some of my colleagues have not stood up.
Like who?
Well, I'm not going to name names, but the point is that they're keeping their head down, and here's what they're rationalizing in their heads. Now, they'll tell you, if it's just the two of you, you know, the guy's nuts. You know, he doesn't have a grasp of the issues. He's making brash decisions. He's not listening to the people who know the subject matter. But in public, if they go after him, they know they get a primary. And they know that's tough. And they watched what happened to their colleagues who did go after him. And neither one of them are coming back. So in their minds, it's, I'm going to keep my head down. We're going to do what we can to thwart his worst instincts, to check his worst instincts, and then I can stick around and this will be over soon. So it's like, look down and just hold your breath. It'll be over. This isn't going to last forever. This is a completely different Republican Party. Now, I think history will judge some of my colleagues harshly that they didn't stand up to this president at some of the moments where he has been unhinged about particularly the rule of law.
Personally, though, when you heard that the president was involved in an apparent hush money scheme to silence women that he may have had affairs with, what was your reaction to that?
Well, it's weird that it's not a bigger deal. I mean, he's almost the master of, I'm going to do so much stuff that's crazy that nobody notices crazy anymore. And that's kind of where we find ourselves. I mean, Kanye West was in the Oval Office MFing on live TV.
We have to make it more exciting. We have to mix curriculum.
I mean, think about that. That is,
I love this guy right here.
Crazy weird.
Are you going to stay in Washington?
No. Oh, no, no, no. I'm taking a train out of toxic land here. I am not going to be in Washington. I'm going to be home mostly, but I've got other things planned, I hope, that will allow some travel. And, you know, my mouth has gotten me in a lot of trouble during these years in public service. I figure now, sky's the limit. Mm-hmm. I can really get in trouble with my mouth.
Back here with the panel to dissect some of this. One of the things that I want to that she mentioned was interesting was talking about her advice for the Democratic Party, saying, you know, we needed to focus on tangible, achievable results. Her concern was, you talk about these big policy ideas like tuition-free college, never going to happen, at least it probably won't happen, and then it feeds cynicism among voters, it gives rise to people like Donald Trump to rail against Washington. But this is going to be a huge debate for this party come 2020, how exactly you position yourself, and do you embrace the more middle-of-the-ground road, or do you talk about these big issues?
Yeah, I think she had some really salient advice for folks like Elizabeth Warren, who noticed she didn't say she thought could win her red state. Ahead of this primary, hey, don't veer too far to the left. I mean, you can go left, do what you got to do to win, but I think McCaskill's words there are important. You know, you got to leave room to tell people here's what's really possible, not just a dream of what I really would do in a fantasy world.
Yeah, and it's, of course, very hard in a campaign environment. She did mention an interesting thing about her own campaign, about Brett Kavanaugh, on the impact that the Kavanaugh fight had on her race and whether it cost her her seat.
There were a number of things beyond our control. Donald Trump won my state by almost 20 points. He camped out so often in Missouri the last 30 days, I figured he was building a golf course. We had the Kavanaugh spectacle combined with the caravan optics, combined with him being there every 10 minutes.
So if Anthony Kennedy did not step down from the Supreme Court, you think you'd have won that race?
I think it would have been much more likely.
She says much more likely she'd have won if it weren't for the Kavanaugh fight. I mean, I'm wondering, you look back, Jake, at the midterms this year, how much did Kavanaugh shape things? Because obviously it helped Democrats, too, energize their base, but ultimately could it have affected things in the Senate, too?
Tough to say. I was traveling right after the Kavanaugh stuff, and I think the one thing I saw that's tangible is was fervor among Republican donors and Republicans who are already in the camp to get out and vote. I think it's tough to make that argument in a state that the president won by 20 points, in a state that had been trending away from Claire McCaskill for a very long time, that's represented by all but I think one all Republicans besides one Democrat in the House. So I think it's a tough argument to make, but maybe you disagree.
Well, you know, I was in Tennessee right as all of the Kavanaugh stuff was going down toward the end there, and there was clearly an uptick in Republican interest in the election. You know, in the month of September, before Kavanaugh became a thing, we forget, the Democrats were starting to profit from this idea that they could possibly win the Senate because the doldrums were setting for Republicans. We're going to lose the House. things don't look good, and voter interest on the right wasn't really that great. And Kavanaugh just energized them and gave them something to believe in. And in states where Trump is potent, like Tennessee where I was, like Missouri, it had the effect, I think, of putting the lid on any hope for Democratic upsets. Yeah. And I think that's why it was so key to what ended up happening in the Senate. Just one thing I want to say about your interview with McCaskill, which I thought was fascinating, was that she had a chance to take some key votes with the president over the last couple of years. She decided not to every time. So there may be some crazy Democrats in Missouri, but she didn't do herself any favors by trying to at least say, on the votes you notice and you like Trump, I'm with them on those votes. Joe Manchin did a much better job of that.
She didn't separate that. And one thing she also said is that she believes that Republicans, privately, she said they tell her that Trump is nuts. That's what she said, you're nuts. I'm wondering, you know, in the new Congress, you look at the membership of the new Senate, are any of these people you think are going to speak out, particularly as more comes out about the Mueller investigation, the report comes out? Do you think that dynamic's going to shift at all, or is it going to be pretty much Democrats railing against Trump and Republicans hiding?
It's really hard for me to see that this dynamic is going to suddenly shift. I mean, Republicans knew what Trump was when he was running for president. They voted for him anyway. They backed him anyway. The ones who refused to endorse him came back around. They voted with him once he got, you know, won the presidency, came to Washington. So it's hard for me to see that all of a sudden they're going to wake up re-energized in 2019 and they're going to be out there really holding his feet to the fire. I think, you know, what you're more likely to see is what we're dealing with Mitch McConnell in the negotiations right now, is sort of, you know, stepping back a little bit and saying, you know, this is your fight.
That's right. I'm sure there'll be a lot of that in the months ahead. And before we go to break, outgoing Defense Secretary James Mattis had a warm message for the troops just one day before he filed his resignation.
Since Washington crossed the Delaware at Christmas in 1776, American troops have missed holidays at home to defend our experiment in democracy. To all you lads and lasses holding the line in 2018, on land, at sea, or in the air, thanks for keeping the faith. Merry Christmas, and may God hold you safe.